All right, hey, how we're doing today? Today's lesson is the period of time after the War of 1812, when James Monroe takes office in 1816, commonly referred to as the era of good feelings. He is taking advantage of the prosperous boon that he's going to gain from James Madison, who led us through the War of 1812. We're going to have Monroe picking up after him. And he's going to be picking up the torch for the Democratic Republicans as they carry America forward into the post-war era, the era of good feelings. It was originally coined when James Madison in 1817 took a trip around the country, the 13 states at that time, plus some other territories and stuff, visiting them, trying to promote unity amongst the country now that the war was over and that a lot of our personal issues with political issues were behind us now. A lot of the hard feelings that we had towards one another that were prominent in our politics before the War of 1812 are now going to be kind of forgotten. You know, people feel good after winning a war. You know, yay, we kicked the British butt one more time. It really left America feeling optimistic about our future. It set us as a world power on the stage. Now, obviously, we weren't in competition with the British. I mean, the British were huge, and we were still very small and insignificant as far as influence in the world, but we do have a presence at this point. People in the world are respecting us for our ideas and thoughts and the way we are doing things. James Monroe is going to benefit from that. Matter of fact, in the election of 1816, he will defeat a guy named Rufus King. You never heard of him before, right? Rufus King was the Federalist candidate. He will lose badly. He'll get like 30 votes to Madison's 230-some votes. Anyway, if we call it back down here, a real butt-kicking, if you will. He's not going to Rufus is not going to win. And it is pretty much a signal to the rest of the Federalist Party that they're done. The Federalist Party is over with. If you think back, they had lost a lot of power thanks to John Adams. Now, John Adams, he was a very strict Federalist. He had these ideas, especially with his Sedition Act and Alien Act. He had basically set up sort of a dictatorship. He really stepped on a lot of American civil liberties, a lot of rights of free speech and things like that. And Americans did not like that. He pretty much tried to turn the country into a dictatorship or some kind of tater, if you will. A lot of people just, when they looked at him after that, the Federalist Party lost a lot of seats in the next election simply because they came off the Federalist Party came off too harsh for most Americans to stand. And, of course, then Thomas Jefferson, thanks, TJ, he'll bring us, like the Louisiana Purchase, and he'll go down in history as a great president, and he'll continue on with the Democratic-Republican Party. And, of course, the Federalists will lose some more positions in the House of Representatives and in the Senate. And then, of course, you have James Madison, who will take us into the War of 1812 with encouragement from the War Hawks. They will, of course, we'll win the war, and this will to bring the Federalists down a little bit more. And then when Rufus King loses to James Monroe in 1816, it is pretty much the death knell at this point. Dong, 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 the Federalists are dead, sort of. A lot of them will actually come back in other political parties, and particularly in the 1820s, a new group will come out known as the Whigs. That's W-I-G-G-S, the Whigs. They're pretty much Federalist, if you will, of a different coat. They basically went and had a facelift and came back. We're new, we're the Whigs, sort of new, but for now, the Federalists are dead. Their party is pretty much non-existent as far as government goes. And Monroe is going to take the benefits of winning the war, being the predecessor of two great Democratic Republican presidents, and he is going to take on a lot of issues with a now Democratic Republican strong Congress. He's going to basically be able to do pretty much anything he wants to as far as benefits for the country without too much opposition. I mean, now the opposition issues are going to be more along the lines of what will benefit your states, not political party debates. You're not going to have, ooh, I'm a Republican, ooh, I'm a Democrat. You're not going to have that going on. You're going to have pretty much, ooh, I'm in Tennessee and I'm worried about what's good for Tennessee, and I'm in New York and I'm worried about what's good for New York, and that kind of thing. It's not going to be a political party biting each other because it's pretty much one political party at this point. It's going to be more of what benefits my state the most kind of thing. So today we're going to look at those things. In particular, what was going on in the country? Well, like I said, everything was going along pretty good. We felt pretty optimistic. We had beat the British for a second time. We had the old Louisiana Purchase. People were heading west in expansionism. Pilgrims had less to fear from the Native Americans. Not saying the Native Americans completely gave up or anything like that, but we were moving and colonizing, well, not colonizing, but becoming pilgrims and setting up these new territories, which will later become states, pretty rapidly for the foreseeable future for the country. So that was pretty optimistic. The things we had problems with, well, the economy. The American economy had kind of hit a slump coming out of the American Revolution. During the American Revolution, not the American Revolution, the War of 1812, I'm sorry. During the War of 1812, America had been cut off by the British Navy from trading with France and other countries. We also weren't getting any British goods, obviously, because we were fighting a war with them. So they pretty much cut us off from everybody. And of course, we weren't trading with anybody else because we couldn't get our stuff through the British blockades out there into the markets and stuff. It was a real problem for us. So basically, during the War of 1812, America, if you wanted to buy something, you had no choice but to buy Made in America or not have it at all. That was your two choices. Either buy Made in America or forget it. That was it. A lot of American industries took advantage of this, and it really helped the American economy, especially in the North. A lot of new factories were built, a lot of new products were built, and America saw a huge growth in that area. However, all good things come to an end. The war ends, we win, but when that happens, the world market opens back up. Now, that is a good thing on one hand, because now we can start trading our goods once again with the rest of the world. But on the other hand, they can start trading with us. And in particular, the British. If you remember from last year's courses during this period of time of the 1790s through the mid-1840s, was a period of time known as the British Industrial Revolution. And the steam engine, y'all remember all this stuff, right? Factories, child labor, machinery, all this good stuff. Watts and everybody else that had involvement in that. England was on a high, this was the Victorian era in which England was producing goods at a rapid amount, cheap goods, manufactured goods. I'm not saying that America didn't have factories, we had factories. But they weren't on the scale that the British had. The British had been really building this up big time. And a lot of, even in our manufacturing industry, in the factories that we did have, a lot of the products were still handmade. There were still some components handmade. And anything that's handmade drives the cost up. See, handmade equals craftsmanship, and craftsmanship equals, that's right, people, money. Lots and lots of money. You buying something handmade, it's going to cost you more. And that's what we came up with. And when we started trading again with the rest of the world, the British flooded our markets with cheap industrial manufactured goods, and our factories simply just couldn't keep up. I mean, it was pretty pathetic. You know, if you want to take the whole economic teaching method of the widget, if we had a widget that cost a dollar to make in America and to ship it from, say, New York to North Carolina cost 25 cents, that meant that item, by the time it got on the shelf here in Madison, North Carolina, would cost $1.25. The same widget, mass produced in England, could be produced for 50 cents. And even though it was being shipped from England to North Carolina, it only added about 50 cents to the cost of the product. So here is a product from America, made in America, handmade, $1.25, our widget, $1.25 on the shelf, and the English version is only a dollar because they could make it cheaper, even despite the cost and shipping differences. So you have that going on, and what ended up happening was is this really put a strain on the American industry. And to make things worse, the British began doing some unfair practices in their trade, a thing called dumping. This is where a established company like they had in England could sell their goods at below market cost. Basically, instead of selling that widget for a dollar, they would sell that widget for 50 cents. They would just eat the cost of making the product. And what that would do is you know, you had the now you have the American-made widget. It's sitting over here on the shelf and it's at $1.25, and you have the British widget at 50 cents. And of course, nobody in their right mind is going to buy the American-made good because, well, I mean, it costs twice as much or even more in this particular case. So what ends up happening is this actually drives a lot of these new, young, fledgling industries in America. It drives them out of business. They go bankrupt. We didn't have 40 or 50 or 100 years of being in business to lean on our credit until the prices bounced back. You know, as the English, they took a loss those couple years. You know, when you dump products, you know, they're not making any money. Matter of fact, they're even losing money. But the idea is they would rather lose money and drive us out of business than to allow the American industry to grow, because they were looking at the long-term picture. If these American products actually got out there and got established and whatnot, then we would be real competition with their other buyers and sellers and stuff. So basically, they just practiced this form of dumping to drive us out of business. And this caused some major problems. What the solution was? Well, we'll get to that in a little bit. Another problem going on in the American economy was in 1811, the charter for the First National Bank ended. And it basically, you know, we closed shop and we reverted back to individual state banks to run the finances of America. And because we were busy with the American Revolution and some other reasons, we just didn't have a lot of time to deal with this issue. So when you look at the banking situation, what ends up happening is a lot of state banks, they don't check themselves. You know, every once in a while you need somebody to look over your shoulder and give you some guidelines. You know, you can't do this or it'll be bad for you. And what ended up happening was a lot of banks in America started lending more money than they should. And this caused rampant inflation. They also, to cover the amount of money that they were lending, some of these banks even started printing their own money again. And this really devalued the American money to the point that inflation went up. If the value of the dollar goes down, cost of things go up. The bottom line is if your dollar bill is only worth 50 cents, then you can't expect to buy a dollar's worth of goods for that dollar anymore. You know, what you could buy for a dollar last week is now going to cost you $2. That kind of thing. And what happened was, is for a lot of Americans, we weren't making any more money. I mean, the average worker wasn't making any money. If you made 10 cents a day or a dollar a day back then, which 10 cents a day was a been a fair price back then. If you made 10 cents a day, that 10 cents just didn't buy what it bought yesterday, thanks to these banks messing up the financial situation. Eventually, it gets so bad that in 1816, the United States will write a new charter, a 20-year charter, with the Second Bank of the United States, and it's going to take charge of this financial situation. We basically, for 5 years there, didn't have a national bank. If you're in North Carolina, you went to the Bank of North Carolina and hoped to God the people there were doing their job and being smart. And if they weren't, well, inflation, value of the dollar, there you go. But now we have the Second National Bank, and it's going to do several things. Number one, it is going to control the amount of loans being lent out. And number two, it's going to control the supply of money. It is basically going to tell these banks, you can't print money. Only the federal bank can print money. And then they're going to control that amount of money until they bring the dollar back up and inflation back down. That will greatly help the economy. Some of the things that were needed to be done. Well, we have this whole new Democratic Republican Congress working with James Monroe, and they're going to have some new big figures in here. People that you'll need to know are people like Henry Clay from Kentucky. He was a big supporter of the tariffs. Tariffs? What do you ask? What is a tariff, Mr. Williams? Well, this is real simple. A tariff is a tax on goods coming into the country. Remember that widget we had from England? Well, to make that widget equal to the price, or at least let the American company have a chance at competing, they would add a tax on the British widget when it came into the country so that its price versus the American-made price would be equal, or at least by a somewhat fair, so that Americans would have a choice. Now, Henry Clay believed this was a great idea. First of all, he believed that the taxes made from these import taxes, these tariffs, should be used to help build up the infrastructure of America, build roads, bridges, canals, things like that. Now, why was Henry Clay so concerned about that? Well, Kentucky was on the other side of the Appalachian Mountains, and if you were a farmer in Kentucky and you wanted to get your crops to market, you had two ways of getting it to market. Number one, you could head back east over the Appalachian Mountains and carry them by wagon or mule train all the way back to the markets in the east, or you could go west to the Mississippi River, get a boat on the Mississippi River, navigate the Mississippi River all the way down to New Orleans, find a boat in New Orleans, load your cargo on the boat in New Orleans, sail it out into the Gulf of Mexico, around Florida, around the Keys, around the Bahamas, all the way up the Atlantic Eastern Coast board, and finally up to a East Coast port, and there sell your markets in the east that way. Now, the difference is 500 miles across land or 2,000 plus miles down and around. And that was a long trip. The real problem here came is which one was most cost efficient. Time-wise, they were about the same. Took about 3 months to travel that 2,000 miles by water, and it took about 3 months to cross the Appalachian Mountains. Reason being, no roads. That's right, ladies and gentlemen. If you had to come out of Tennessee and cross the Great Smoky Mountains to bring your stuff to markets in Raleigh, North Carolina, you looked at those mountains and you looked at the mule train that you were hauling them up behind you up the goat path. Any hunters out there, you'll know exactly what I'm talking about, the deer paths and things like that. That have been pretty much your way of getting over the mountains, was finding these animal tracks and trying to lace your way up and over those mountains. I guarantee you there would have been a couple of those mules that would have looked at the Great Smoky Mountains and said, "You must be smoking something. You go over that mountain." But that was some really hard, hard territory to cross. So you have all that going on. If you wanted to bring a wagon over the mountains, you literally had to make the road yourself. You had to cut your way through the wilderness. And until you got to a civilization on the other side of the Appalachian Mountains. And that took a lot of time. That was, two-thirds your journey. That would have been 2 months just to get across the Appalachian Mountains. And that was tough. That was tough. And it cost a lot because, those wagons and things, those require manpower and all the physical effort to get over. That was very costive. As averse to hauling your goods to the Mississippi River and boarding them on boats, it still wasn't easy. You still had to, there weren't locks and canals in some places. So, a lot of times you carried your goods down on one boat, got to a waterfall, and then had to transfer your goods down around the waterfall to a boat down at the bottom, and then keep transferring and transferring and transferring and transferring until you get all the way to Louisiana, down to New Orleans. And there, find a captain to load your goods up on a cargo ship, and then sail them around the Keys and around Florida and up the East Coast. That wasn't easy either. That took quite a bit of time. That was, 3 months of time and labor to get it down there. But it was not as labor intensive as trying to cross the Appalachian Mountains. So Henry Clay suggested that if we could build roads, physical roads, good roads, or open up locks and things like that to make the Mississippi River more passable. This would open up the new territories of the Louisiana Purchase that we had gotten. Thanks again, TJ. And of course, this would have opened up by land the ability for a lot of farmers to haul by wagon train goods into the east, thus opening up all the benefits that these new territories had to our country so that they could begin making money. Another congressman, one of these new Democratic Republican congressmen that wanted some real change, was Daniel Webster. He was a congressman from Massachusetts, and he wanted to have high tariffs, these high tariffs that Henry Clay said he liked. He also wanted them, but he wanted them to protect northern businesses, more northern manufacturers, so that they could compete against especially the British-made goods. The British were just killing us with their industrialized goods that they were sending to America. And of course, he believed these high tariffs would make fair trading practices so that American companies could survive. Last but not least, John C. Calhoun from South Carolina. He opposed these high tariffs. He opposed them readily. He declared that the prosperity of the North would be based on the sweat and the profits of the South. Basically, the South, as far as manufacturing goods, made nothing, big old goose egg. If you couldn't eat it or smoke it, we pretty much didn't have it. Remember, we were agricultural at this time. We made a lot of tobacco and we had a lot of animals and things like that. We were one big giant plantation and farm. We didn't have industry as per se. So if you wanted something made, something industrialized made in the South, you had to buy it from somewhere else. And in particular, I'll wait for that bell to quit ringing. School's out. All right, there we go. No, I'm just kidding. We're right back. So if you wanted to buy something in the South, you had to get it from somewhere else. So let's say you wanted to buy a new teapot or something like that from, that for your wife or something, and you had to buy one. So you had a choice. You either could buy one made in New England at one of the factories, or basically handmade, or buy one from the British or some other European country. Now, before the tariffs, the South loved the dumping that the British were doing because we could buy up all these really cool British-made products for way less than we could buy the New England versions of them. I mean, it was like half the price or even better. They were almost giving it away. But when they asked for these high tariffs, What it did is it raised the price of the British or European-made goods to the point that the people who were paying for these goods were the Southerners. Basically, to make the Northern states richer, the South had to become poorer. And I want to remind you that for the last 200 years, the South had kind of been the money winner in the 13 colonies and in the course of the new 13 states. Coming out of the American Revolution, the South was the big winner as far as money-wise because the plantations were Americans' version of agricultural factories, with slave labor obviously as its working workforce or the machinery of it. And the South had benefited greatly from all that agricultural growth. At this point in the 1820s, you're going to start to see the Southern prosperity begin to go down as the Northern industrialist will go up. And that instead of having rich Southerners, you're going to end up starting having more rich Northerners, and the South is slowly starting to slip into decay, if you will, financially speaking. And one of these things is the tariffs that will do that. But Calhoun adamantly opposed it because it was hurting Southern profits. We just could not afford to buy the goods. Now, Henry Clay, he supported these things and he came up with what was called the American Plan. The American Plan was basically support the big tariffs. The big tariffs, first of all, would protect American industries in the North and allow the North to become more wealthy. To benefit the South, he stated that if the North becomes more wealthy, then the North will buy more Southern goods. So, in the long run, even though it hurt the South to start with these tariffs, that these tariffs would eventually allow the North to become more profitable and thus buy more Southern goods. Thus, the South would become more profitable eventually in the end. And also, the West would become more profitable because he suggested that we use the monies made from these tariffs to build up the infrastructure so that the Midwest states along the Louisiana Purchase and the Ohio River Valley areas could now begin trading with the rest of the world on an equal footing and getting those products to market. They just had to figure out how to get it out of the center of the country and get it out there to the world to start making big moolah, big money. Henry Clay had this plan. It was never fully achieved. His ideas, his plan. The tariffs did go in. The South did lose money. The roads were eventually built, but the roads were not built to the necessary standards that everybody had hoped for. And of course, the tariffs were never put in as well as everybody in the North hoped for. And of course, the South was not hopeful because the tariffs that did make it in were hurting the South. So nobody really got happy about it, but enough of it did go in to allow the American economy to begin to bounce back. Okay, let's take a look at a few Supreme Court cases that we need to take a closer look at that also happened during this time. The first one in 1819, this is McCulloch. Versus Maryland. This is where the state of Maryland decides that they're going to tax or try to tax the Second Bank of the United States. This is something that the Supreme Court is going to strike them down on. They're not going to be allowed to tax it. They state that states cannot tax federal institution or it violates federal law. So this is a big thing here. Probably the number one thing you need to remember about this particular one is it strengthens the federal government in the aspect that if it has to do with the federal government, states cannot monkey with it. Federal government is supreme on this particular issue. And since the I know that the National Bank theoretically is a independent company, due to the fact that it has a charter with the United States government, it is a part of the United States government in that particular aspect. So, you can't, states can't tax that institution. And it states very clearly that states don't have the right to interfere or tax federal institutions. The next one we need to look at is Dartmouth College versus Woodward, and this also in 1819. Basically, the state of New Hampshire wanted to change the charter. Now, a charter is a agreement or a document in which in which two parties come to agreement upon, and powers or something are given to a person or company. In this particular case, a college. The college was had an agreement with the state, and the state didn't like the terms. They decided they wanted to change the terms. And what's going to happen is the Supreme Court is going to side on the college's side, stating that the state cannot change it because it is a contract, a legal contract, and it is protected under the Constitution. Thing for you to remember here is it's going to help businesses and stuff, stating that the state governments cannot go back in and change contracts and stuff without the consent of the other party. You have to have both parties, the both parties that agreed upon it have to agree upon it. Just because the state doesn't like the terms or something doesn't mean they can just throw out a contract and start anew, or write a new one, or just take out a big eraser and start erasing away things they don't like about it. So that's a big thing you need to remember. It promotes capitalism, and that charters and contracts are protected under the U.S. Constitution. And the last one you need to learn about is Gibbon versus Auden. This is happens in 1824. It is when the state of New York started selling monopolies to this is where a monopoly, if you can't remember what a monopoly is when you have complete control of something. One person gets complete control of something. Usually it has to do with business. They started selling monopolies to ship steamboat captains who had a monopoly. They were the only ones who could use the river. And New York was selling these leases, if you will, or permissions for single companies to operate on the Hudson River. Well, this was taken to court because the Hudson River isn't just in or in New York. New York, the Hudson River also runs through another state. And the federal government's going to come in, and they're going to state that they are the only ones who can regulate interstate commerce. For those of you who don't remember what interstate commerce is, that's trade between two states. Number one thing you need to remember, only the federal government can regulate interstate commerce. That's the main thing to remember about this. You know, this is one of these cases where New York was kind of wanting to get some sort of benefit. They also couldn't, like, you know, close the mouth of the Hudson River and you know, put a big troll there going, you got to pay your tolls or you can't get in or out of it. No, that's not something that they can do. Only the federal government. If the federal government says you can't do it, you can't do it. So just keep that in mind. McCulloch versus Maryland, 1819, strengthened federal government. Dartmouth College versus Woodward in 1819, promoted capitalism and proved that private contracts were protected under the Constitution. And Gibbons versus Auden in 1824 stated that the federal government was the only one who could regulate interstate commerce. All right, one last thing before I sign off today. I did make a mistake earlier in the videoing of this lecture. I stated earlier that Rufus King lost to James Monroe in the election, which he did, but I stated the numbers wrong. He lost to Monroe. King got 34 votes, and Monroe got 183 votes. I just want to get those numbers right. You know, I said it was like 230 something. That was wrong. It was 34 to 183. Still, big butt whooping. He lost, and the Federalists die from that. Remember, this was the death knell, dong, 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 for the Federalist Party. Sort of. They do come back, but with a new name. And anyway, that was the biggest mistake that I saw that I made earlier today. That's pretty much it. Just remember to look over your notes, make sure that you answered your worksheet, and if you have any questions, refer back to the PDF documents here on Canvas. And
well, you
I'll
can tell everybody.
I'll see you guys tomorrow.
Yeah, you can tell everybody. Go ahead and tell everybody. I'm the man, I'm the man, I'm the man. Yes, I am, yes, I am, yes, I am. I'm the man, I'm the man, I'm the man. I believe every lie that I ever told. Paid for every heart that I ever stole. I played my cards and I didn't fold. Well, it ain't that hard when you got sold. Somewhere I heard that life is a test. I've been through the worst, but I still get my best. God made my mold different from the rest. Then he broke that mold, so I know I'm blessed. Stand up now and face the sun. Won't hide my tail or turn and run. It's time to do what must be.